We never intended to plant a church.
We are Christians.
We needed to have devotion with our kids, Bible study with our kids. So started Bible study here. And I think we probably are not realizing what's going on.
We had one parent showed up. He was just passing by. We were in the middle of doing Bible study with our kids. Oh, you guys having Bible study? Then he totally spread the word, and families started to come in and show up and say, if we are bringing the kids to Bible study, why don't we have church for everybody? I guess they saw something that they couldn't find in our area.
That's how we ended up planting a Haitian church right here in Philadelphia. It was designed with kids in mind.
My name is Keisha Renee, and I'm 16 years old. When God picks somebody to do a job, he doesn't, like, go off of the age that you are. You have to be willing to just do whatever God needs you to do. And I just felt like I had a job to do.
There are kids standing, leading the service. They are integrated. They are part of everything that we do. And families come because of what the Lord is doing. Raising generations of children, of people, of servants. And God is at work. But it started with that burden of seeing something different. So not even a year ago did we think that we were ever going to be in such a circumstance. But we would rather do nothing else but this. This is it. This is what transpires for an eternity.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to First Baptist Church. Please join, stand with us, join us in worship.
Come, thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Please have a seat.
Good morning, everyone. If you wonder why I sat down there instead of up here, let me make you parents feel better. I have crazy kids. So if I can help control them for a few minutes, I'll do that because they're out of control. So if you're a parent here and you bring your kids and you feel awkward about that or feel like you're bothering somebody else, I can assure you that you're not bothering me and you're not bothering anybody else. But we also have nursery services too, so you can always take them there. That's what I threatened my four-year-old with. If he's not better, he's going to go to the nursery with the babies. So, good to see everybody here. Next week is, guess what? What is it?
Easter.
Easter Sunday. So if you're thinking about somebody, got somebody on your mind, in your mind, make sure to invite people. We always have more people here on Easter than maybe any other Sunday other than Christmas Sunday. So it's a great time to invite. Some people are more likely to come on Easter than just a random Sunday sometimes. So make sure to invite them. Bring them out. We are having both services, right?
Yes.
Both services.
One at 8,
one at 10:15. We have Sunday, what? Not 10:40, 10:15. Oh, well, it happens. 8 and 10:15, if you don't have a Sunday school class but would like to be in one, we do have Sunday school classes that meet 9 o'clock, and I guarantee there's a class with people that are close to your age or people that you know, people that you're familiar with, comfortable with. Just ask somebody after church or when you're greeting people around, and they will help direct you to a Sunday school class that you will feel comfortable in. So we are going to say a prayer, and after we pray, everybody that's here, if you see somebody you haven't seen in a while, which I see Patrick Kelly here, he's got his Sunday best on. Good to see him from out of town today. I grew up with Patrick. We sat right up here in church every Sunday. So I remember those times as a kid. So make sure you greet somebody you haven't seen in a while, somebody that you've never seen. Make sure that they know how glad we are to have them here and that they feel welcome while they're here. So we're going to pray, greet each other, and then Andre is going to lead us in worship. And Brother Joe has the greatest Palm Sunday message in the history of Palm Sunday messages, right? It's all you, Billy Graham. It's all you, right? All right, let's pray, and we're going to keep the worship service going. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the people that are here. We thank you for those that are home, those that are watching on YouTube, those that are watching on Facebook. We thank you for those that are wanting to come, haven't came yet. Make next week be the week that they come and hear the Word of God on Easter Sunday, which is the greatest Sunday that we have. It's the true meaning behind our religion and the day that changed everything when you rose again. We ask you to be with those in our community. There's been lots going on, plenty of hurt, plenty of sickness. We ask that you to comfort those families that need comfort. We ask you to wrap your arms around them and give them peace that's just unexplainable at this time. We ask you to be with Brother Joe as he brings the message. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Joe told me one other thing I forgot. We have an Annie Armstrong. I forgot the one thing you told me. The Annie Armstrong Easter offering was up there. I saw it was $3,500, and we've raised about $1,500, I thought I saw. So $2,000 more to our goal. That was what the video was about before, and that's about starting churches here in North America. We always think about around the world, but it's an offering that helps plant churches and launch churches and do mission work right here in North America. So at this time, everyone stand up, greet somebody around them.
Enough. Thank you.
I am not what I make, I am who you would make me to be. I am not what I've done, I am loved unconditionally. I am not loved by the measure of love that I bring. I am not who I know, I am known by the King of all kings. Jesus, you are enough. Jesus, you are enough for me. Jesus, you are enough for me. You are maker, made visible, holding the world in your hands. You are patient and merciful, a giver of grace without end. Satisfied simply by being always been. You are infinite love and you prove it again and again. Jesus, you are enough. Jesus, you are enough for me. With nothing, I still have everything. Jesus, you are enough for me. Jesus, you are enough. Jesus, you are enough for me. With nothing, I still have everything. Jesus, you are enough for me. The grave. With you I stand in victory. Now what else could I need? With you I want for nothing. Jesus, my everything. Jesus, you are enough. Jesus, you are enough for me. With nothing, I still have everything. Jesus, you are enough for me. Jesus, you are enough. Jesus, you are enough for me. With nothing, I still have everything. Jesus, you are enough.
Of mercy, I'm you've done is so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence, and I'm overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed by you, God. I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed by you. You are beautiful. You are beautiful. Oh God, there is no one more beautiful. You are beautiful. God, you are the most beautiful. You are wonderful. You are wonderful. Oh God, there is no one more wonderful. You are wonderful. God, you are the most wonderful. You are glorious, you are glorious. Oh God, there is no one more glorious. You are glorious, God, you are the most glorious. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed.
Stain and he washed it white as snow.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Pray with me. Jesus, we thank you for what you did on the cross for us. We thank you for your mercy to us, Lord, and your faithfulness to us, and your goodness. And we ask that you'll move in here today, Lord, that you'll prepare everyone here to receive from you, to hear from you today. Lord, if there's someone here who doesn't know you today, we ask that that'll change today. Be with Joe as he comes. Give him your word. Give him boldness, Lord. It's in the name of Jesus we pray.
Good morning. It's good to see you this morning. If you're 4 years old through fourth grade, you can exit right out this door. We got children's church for you. It's good to see you this morning. Hope you're doing well. Everybody's weekend go well? It did so far for the University of Illinois, didn't it? I heard yesterday they beat Quoin. Did you see that? All right. Well, I'm glad you're here. We're going to take a break today from the study of James. So we're not looking at James today. Today we're going to, though, answer a very important question. Go ahead and put that question up there. Yep. We're getting close to Easter, so I thought we'd take a couple Sundays and kind of look at some of the issues. And today, the question I want to answer is, why did Jesus have to die? Right? You know, growing up, I was a PK. That means preacher's kid. And they don't really have that good of reputations, do they, preacher's kids? But I was a preacher's kid. You know, you have to go to church every time the doors are open if you're a preacher's kid, if you want to or not. And I used to really like the story of Jesus, especially when I was little. The only thing I didn't like about it is the way it ended. Right? This whole part of Jesus being crucified just kind of put a damper on the whole thing, didn't it? Right? You think about it. Jesus was on a great roll. He had people coming to him. He was healing people. He was teaching people. Right? He had people just all over. He'd become really popular. Little kids were coming to him, flocking to him. And then you get this kind of ridiculous ending. Right? In other words, why'd they have to put him on a cross and kill him? Right? It just seemed like a good question. Right? Why? And a lot of people actually have wondered about this. Why did they put Jesus on the cross? Why did he go to the cross? And I don't know if you know the answer to that, but we're going to look at that this morning. In fact, what I'd like to do is go ahead and put that next slide up. There it is. Several years ago now, probably 2004, so it's been 20 years or right about this time, this was the cover of Time magazine. I think it was April. Can't see it on that one. April of 2004, that was the cover. The cover says, why did Jesus have to die? And so when you open it up and you read the article, there's this long article, and it's debating why Jesus died. You know, they just kind of went into the whole thing why Jesus had to die on the cross. And I want to start with this. First of all, why did Jesus come? And the short answer of that whole thing is this: Jesus came to die. All right, he came primarily to die on the cross, and he spoke of it in great detail. If you read the Gospels, you'll see this: the death of Jesus might have been a surprise to everybody else, but it was not a surprise to him. Right. In other words, when you just read the Gospels, you'll see Jesus made statements like this all the time. The Son of Man is going to be betrayed. The Son of Man is going to be taken away from you, and he's going to die. He's going to be murdered, and then on the third day rise. He told his disciples that. But here's the thing. When he was talking to them, he might as well have been talking to a wall. He couldn't get through their thick skulls that this was going to be what was going to happen. And even when he was killed, after, you know, he'd been saying it for, 3 years, and then when he was killed, what did they do? They were very shocked. They're like, oh no, it's all done. This whole thing is over. The gig's up, right? And they weren't realizing this, that he was doing exactly what he said he was going to do. In fact, put the next slide up. I want you to see this one. This is John chapter 12. And what happens in the book of John, if you're, we've studied the book of John before. When you get to about chapter 12, it's the week from 12 to the very end. It's the week of Jesus's getting ready to die. And so everything really slows down in that book, in chapter 12, and it starts going through just everything that happened, what Jesus said and all. And so here in chapter 12, Jesus talks, and look what he says. Check it out. Week before he died, he says, "Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save them from this hour. But for this purpose, I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." In that moment, Jesus was telling them, "Hey, I've come. The reason why I came was to die. This is my purpose for coming." And he was like, he was fixing his eyes on the cross, right? And Jesus would say over and over different times, "Since the Son of Man has come to give his life as a ransom for many." See, Jesus was born to die, y'all. That's why he came. So many people, by the way, though, didn't get this. They don't understand the significance of what took place on that Roman cross 2,000 years ago, right? In fact, the cross itself, if you look at it today, it's kind of like a fashion symbol. If you look at the cross today, there's a lot of rappers and rockers with the cross on. Isn't there? It's kind of like a fashion symbol. You see all these rockers with it on, and you'll see rappers like Kanye West and Lil Nas. They got these, they wear a cross. Have no idea what it really means. But they'll wear it. In fact, there was a, it's been several years now, but Madonna used to end her concert being put on a cross. Just ridiculous, right? Now, so it's just basically, for a lot of people, it's just a religious ornament. In fact, I heard a story about, it was a true story, about a couple that goes into a jewelry store. And they were looking at various crosses. The jeweler was showing them different crosses to look at. And she said, "Well, I really like these crosses, but do you have any with the little man bleeding on them off? Is there any that don't have that?" And I thought about that for a second when I read that story. Isn't that what people want? They want a cross without Jesus. Right? A cross without any offense. We want to wear it because we think it looks cool with our outfit. It looks cool. But without any idea what it really means. And if you could transport yourself, if you could get the flux capacitor, remember that? And you could get that thing. Some of y'all know, you got to be a child of the 80s probably. Back to the Future. If you could go back 2,000 years to the time of Christ and look at the cross, it was anything but a religious ornament. Right? It was a vile and bloody symbol. In fact, today it'd be like wearing the lethal injection or the electric chair around your neck. Right? It was the worst picture possible to see a dude like hanging on a cross. Crucifixion, if you look at the history, it was invented by the Persians in about 500 BC. And then the Romans come along and they perfect it. They perfect this, the cross. And it wasn't even outlawed until the time of Constantine, which is about 325 AD. And in those days, when Jesus was around, the crucifixion was reserved for the worst offenders. In fact, if you were a Roman citizen, you couldn't even be, they wouldn't let you. You weren't allowed to be killed by crucifixion. They'd cut your head off or stab you or whatever. They wouldn't let you be killed like this because you're a Roman citizen. The Jews, by the way, also knew how bad this was. And here's what they say. Next slide. Deuteronomy says this, 21. It says, "And if a man has committed a crime punishable by death and he's put to death, and you hang him on a tree, his body shall not remain all night on the tree, but you shall bury him the same day, for a hangman is cursed by God." The crucifixion, the cross was a vile, bloody event. In fact, the pain associated with the cross was so severe, they invented a word for it. It's called excruciating. You ever, anybody heard that word? Anybody? When you say excruciating pain, excruciating literally means from the cross. It's how bad it was. It was a terrible, terrible way to die. And the Romans took crucifixion to an art form. The reason they chose crucifixion, by the way, is because it was meant to be a slow, torturous death. You didn't just die like that, right? If you want to put someone to death immediately, you just, like I said, you'd cut their head off, you know, or stab them or whatever. Crucifixion was not designed to do that. It was designed to be a painful death. And it was a humiliating death. So the people that were hanging on the cross, what the Romans would do is if there was a rebellion or if they wanted to put, you know, really sick, they would take these crosses and they would line them on the road. And you would see these people and you're supposed to look at them and go, you better not mess with Rome. This is a serious thing. And so that's why they did it. Now, let me go back to this. Of course, God allowed this to happen to his own son because it was in his plan. Amen? In fact, if you read, there's a lot, it's predicted all over the place. Psalm 22, if you read it, it predicts it 1,000 years before it happened. That this is the way the Messiah is going to die. You want to know who the Messiah is? Look at this. If this happens to them, and they were, before crucifixion was ever invented, it's foretold in the Bible. 1,000 years before. It's amazing. Now you say, well, Job, why? I get he came to die, but why did he have to die? Why did this have to happen? Well, it all started like this. See, it all started with God created the world. And when he created the world, guys, he created it good. Amen? It says it. If you read Genesis 1, chapter 1 and chapter 2, you'll see God created the plants, created them good. He created the hippos, created them good. All the animals, all the birds, everything, and he created it good. And then he created man as his final creation, and he put him in a garden. The Bible says it was all good. He's in the garden, and how couldn't it be? You didn't have to worry about designer clothes back then. You didn't even have to wear clothes. It's all good. Your body was perfect. All you did is sit around eating fruits and nuts. Perfect. But God said one thing. He said, don't eat of the tree that's in the middle of the garden. In other words, eat every other tree, but there's going to be one tree, and it's going to be in the middle. Don't eat of that tree. And then he says this, in the day that you eat of it, you will surely what? Yeah, surely die. And they would not only face physical death, but it would be a spiritual death. And what did they do, y'all? They ate of the tree. And the Bible says in that moment, they died. Right? And when Adam sinned, here's what you need to know. When Adam sinned, the Bible says in principle, everybody sinned. In fact, put the next scripture up there. I want to show you this. Here's what it says in Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Just as through one man sin entered into the world. Who's that one man? Adam. And death through sin. Sin spread to all men because all have sinned. Y'all, sin is like an infectious disease. It's worse than COVID. And ain't no mask going to keep you from getting it. In fact, every person who's ever lived has got this infectious disease called sin, right? We're all born with it. And by the way, have you ever noticed how easy it is to sin? Anybody? In other words, you don't have to teach a person how to sin. You got to teach them how to do right, but you ain't got to teach a person how to sin. They can figure that out on their own, can't they? In fact, we've talked about this before. Even a little baby, put that next slide up there. Even a little baby, right? They learn it quickly. In fact, what they learn is this. When I yell and scream, my parents come running. So even if not, we come and we think, well, something's wrong. And then they look and they're going, right? And they learn that if they scream and they yell, parents come running. And when we get older, we basically do the same thing. We just want the world to revolve around us. That's what babies do. You don't have to teach them that. Here's what it comes down to. I'm not a sinner because I sin, but rather I sin because I'm a sinner. It comes naturally. The Bible says we get sin naturally. We got it from Adam, right? And no matter how good we are or how moral we are or how religious we are, everybody's sinned, all right? So this is where Jesus comes in. And this, so we'll start getting into this. Now look at the next slide. Paul's talking and he says this. He says, "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." Now here goes back to our question. Why did Jesus have to die? He had to die for our sin. See, we got a problem. And we all feel this. How many of you can feel and know that the world is broken? Anybody ever watch the news? All we see is a jacked up world. It's broken. It's in trouble. And let me go back to that next slide. Go to the next slide. Now, here's what's interesting about this. The question is asked on there, why did Jesus have to die? You see that? But I look up in the corner. There are two headlines. One says, "Horror in Fallujah." You see that? And the other says, "Confessions of a Tycho Killer." The horror in Fallujah, if you were to read that article, it's about hostility and hatred and murder. That the dark stuff that it's in our human hearts, that the strongest military in the world cannot get out of the human heart. The other story is the Confessions of a Tycho Jurge. It's about greed and it's about corruption at the highest levels. That the most awesome judicial system in the whole world can't get out of the human heart. Why did Jesus have to die? The answer is on the front cover. It's because of sin. Right? It's because of sin. And listen, we're in deep trouble. That's what the Bible tells us. And I want to use kind of an old illustration to bring this out. Go ahead and put the next slide up. Here's what I want to try to get you to understand today. I want you to picture like this. That's not me, but it could be. It's got a suit on, that's not me. But just pretend. All right, on one side, you got a cliff. And you're on it. And then over here on the other side of the Grand Canyon, there's God. He's on the other cliff. And there's this vast chasm in between all of us. And there's a gap. And it's so big, we can't get across it, right? The writers of the scriptures say this, that gap, the reason why it's there, that gap between us and God is because of sin, right? And all of us know there's this, you think about this, there's this longing that we have to have a clean, clear conscience, to love people like we should, to have a connectedness with God. We all know we want that. We feel that, but we know that there is a gap. And the Bible says that it's that gap that is between what we like to be and what we really are, that gap is sin, right? And what's in the human heart from the very beginning has been this idea for thousands of years. It's all about religion. We're all about like, okay, now how can I bridge that gap? I'm going to bridge that gap by trying to do good things. I'm going to try to get to God. I'm going to try to do good things. I'm going to try to get to Him. And everybody does this. They try to bridge the gap. And it reminded me of a story. And maybe you've heard me tell this before. Back when I was younger, I was in middle school. And I had a friend named Kip. I liked Kip because he had a pool in his backyard. Only kid we know. So we'd go over. This is in Marion. We'd go over and we'd play sandlot football. And when we got done, we'd go over to his house. And she always interrupts me. I don't know what's going on there. We'd go over to his pool. His pool was 10, he had a two-story house. And he had a pool about 10 feet away from the house. And back then, I thought about this lately. It probably was not a smart idea. But we didn't know fear back then. And so, does anybody want to guess what the most fun activity in the world was? Next slide, please. Right there. Now, it was a lot of fun. Now, Kip had an aunt named Aunt Myrtle. Aunt Myrtle's in her upper 70s, early 80s. I thought she was about 130, but she was probably somewhere in there. Incidentally, she called us striped snakes. Go ahead and put the next picture up, please. There she is. Remember, I was in 7th or 8th grade. And she would tell us, you cannot bridge the gap. She says, do not do it. This is this is the most important thing. Do not bridge the gap. Do not jump from the house into the pool. All right? So we all said, yes, ma'am. She also called us again, you striped little snakes, stay off the roof. So we would wait, go ahead and put the next picture up, till she went to sleep. And guess what we did? She took an afternoon nap, by the way. Here's the point. The history of the human race is people saying this. I think I can bridge the gap. I think if I do enough good deeds, if I just give enough money, if I just learn enough religious stuff, if I'll just do enough, maybe if I get enough involved in charitable things, I can bridge the gap. And here's the point. Listen to me. Nobody ever has. Nobody's ever got that far. You say, yeah, but I'm better than my neighbor. Well, it's kind of like this. I always try to, because people do that, say, well, I'm better than, you know, Joe. Well, here's the point. Let's say you're at the tip of Florida and the goal is to jump to Cuba. I take off and I jump and I go 7 feet into the water. Did I make it to Cuba? A little bit further than that. And say you can jump further than me and you jump 10 feet. Did you make it to Cuba? Nobody's ever jumped that far. No one's ever bridged the gap, right? Not the best person who's ever lived. They can't even bridge the gap. It's too far away. And this is where the cross comes in, y'all. This is why the gospel is called the good news. Is this, I was separated from a holy, perfect God by my sin, and there's no way I could reach this flawless God. This is foundational Christianity. I need you to hear this morning. This is foundation to whatever you think. The writers of Scripture say that God Himself in Jesus Christ came to this earth. He lived as you and I lived, and He goes to the cross, and He died on the cross, and on the third day He rose again. You see, we're all sinners, and the result of sin, I need to make sure you understand this, the result of sin, the Scripture says, is death. Put that next scripture up. It says, for the wages of sin is what? Death. And that death is eternal death. And death there is the word that means separation. Right? It means separation. And here's the point. The reason why sin is death is because God is a God of the living. He's the God that created everything. He is alive. And to be connected to Him is alive. And if you're disconnected from Him, you're in death. You say, well, Joe, I'm still alive. I'm still breathing. Well, let me give you an illustration. Anybody here have a cell phone? Okay, if you got every baby has a cell phone these days. Everybody's got one. T-Mobile, AT&T, Verizon, thank you. Here's the point. You got a phone, unless you keep that phone connected to the cord, what's going to happen to it? It's going to die. Unless you keep to the source, you die. The Bible says because of sin, you're not connected to the source. So you might be functionally alive. In other words, you're still here, but spiritually you're dead. And one day the Bible says, not only are you spiritually dead, but you'll be physically dead because everybody dies. So that's the problem that we have. So the Bible says that because of sin, we may be physically alive, but we're spiritually dead and one day we die. All right? And this is where Jesus and the good news comes in. Are you ready? First of all, you need to understand this, that Jesus is the only person who's ever lived who's never sinned. The Bible's pretty clear on that. Let's read this verse. It's Hebrews 4:15 says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who is in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without what? He didn't ever sin." But here's the good news. Now you got to hear this. This is where I get excited. He never sinned, but the Bible says he became our sin. Now you say, well, here's the shocking part. I want you to listen closely to this. On the cross as our substitute, Jesus became the worst of the worst. Right? This doesn't mean Jesus ever sinned. What it means is Jesus was made to be sin for us. And here's the point. As a result, here's what happens. In that moment when Jesus cried out, do you remember there was a point on the cross where Jesus goes, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" And it says that God turned his head away. You see, in that moment when he said, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" that Jesus became the most ugly, the most vile, the most wicked, evil, corrupt, rebellious, and hideous thing in all creation, the Bible says. And so I don't want to lessen that, so I want you to hear me. When that moment Jesus became a homosexual, an alcoholic, a thief, a glutton, an addict, a pervert, an adulterer, a coveter, an idol worshiper, a pedophile, a religious, pompous jerk. In that moment, Martin Luther, he doesn't try, he's one of the few theologians who does not lessen it. He calls that time the Great Exchange. What does that mean, Joe? And what that means is this. Scripture declares that on the cross, Jesus exchanged his perfection, y'all, for our imperfection. His obedience for our disobedience. His closeness with God, with our distance from God. Right? His blessing for our cursing. His life for our death. In fact, the scripture says, turn to the next scripture. I want to show you. Isaiah 53:6 says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way." And listen. "And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." Who's him? That's Jesus. The scripture says in 2 Corinthians, says, "For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin." I heard a young man one time ask the question. He said, "Well, you know, why did Jesus have to die?" And some of the people were answering. It was on one of those TikToks or something. And the answer came back, "Well, it's because he ticked off all the religious people." That's not the story, y'all. The story is the Bible teaches that in perfect justice, what happened was because Jesus was made to be our sin, that he died for us. And so what does that mean? That little word "for" in the scriptures has some huge implications. In theological terms, here's what it means. It means that Jesus' death was substitutionary. And there's a big theological word which means penal substitution, which means this. Penal means the penalty. Substitution. His death was in our place solely for our benefit and not for his. All right? In other words, this means that Jesus took the penalty for our sin in our place, and that he suffered for us. He took the wrath of God that should have been for us, for our sin, and God placed it on Jesus. And it wasn't something that was forced on me, y'all. He did it willingly. That's what Jesus did. And scripture kind of just stresses this point over and over. Next slide. Just two scriptures. He was delivered up for our trespasses. God shows his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. For us. So you want to know why he had to die? He had to die for us for our sin. Right? To make a way between where we are and where God is. So that anybody now who wants to have a relationship, an intimate relationship with God, can have it, can know things that are okay with God. Right, to know that you can be assured that one day that you can be with God in heaven. That's why he died. You don't have to wonder. Right? You don't have to. It's not because of the I'll bridge the gap on my own plan. What it is, it's because of what God has already done for you and I through Jesus on the cross. And all you have to do, friends, listen to me, is accept it by grace. There ain't no earning it. It's grace. That means you don't deserve it, but God gives it to you anyways. Right? Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that means that was God's plan for you and I. Now, let me end with this. When Jesus died on the cross, there were two guys on either side of him. Go ahead and put that next. The Bible says that there are two guys, and Matthew's gospel tells us that both of the guys were riding Jesus. The crowd was mocking him, and so were the two guys. Both of them were just telling, if you're the Christ, come down. And they were just mocking him. And then Luke's gospel tells us this, that one of the thieves turns to Jesus and says, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Go ahead and put that next slide up. There you go. Jesus says, truly, truly, today you will be with me in paradise. I love that picture. See, here's the point. With the cross, there's always a choice. There's always a choice, and you're going to have to make. And one of the thieves heard Jesus say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And he chose. And the Bible says that he went to heaven that day. Now, the other guy heard the same thing. He heard what both of them were talking about, and he died, and he died the same way he lived, hardened and unrepentant. And I'll say this, some of you are sitting here today. Some of you are sitting here today, and you hear this message. Some of you will be moved by it. Some of you hear it and you'll be touched by it and you'll want to come into a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. So others of you are going to hear this and you're going to go, phew, I got to get home. The next games are getting ready to start and I've only watched 44 of them already. I got to hurry up. Listen to me. There's nothing I can do to make you believe it. There's nothing I can say. There's no clever argument. It's the drawing of the Holy Spirit. That's what it is. And listen, the Bible says there's power in the message of the gospel. And I've seen over my years, I've been in a long time now, I've seen people that were hardened give their life to Jesus. Come to him and just like that. And I'm confident that there's somebody here. The reason why we talked about this today, there's somebody here that may need to put their faith in Jesus Christ. Right? And here's what I'll tell you. You have to believe that Jesus is who he said he was and put your faith and trust in him and not in yourself. In the other words, there's not many ways to God. I know Oprah says it. She says there's all these roads that lead up to the same mountain. And by the way, that is ridiculous. It's like me going out here and picking a road and saying I can get to Texas from it. Jesus said, there's only one way to God. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. You say, well, Joe, what do I got to do? I'd like to be saved, and I can feel that in my heart. I know I need that. What do I need to do? Well, here, just real quickly, you need to realize you're a sinner. We already talked about it. That ain't take a lot to convince people they're a sinner. Most people get it. We're all born that way. We got to realize that Christ died on the cross for us, right? And you got to turn from your sin. The Bible says this. It says, Repent and be converted, and times of refreshing will come from the presence of the Lord. You got to be willing to turn from your life of sin. You got to put your full faith in Jesus Christ to save you. You must, couple more things. You got to do it publicly. You can't be ashamed. Jesus said, if you're ashamed before me, before men, I'll be ashamed before you, before the Father. You can't be ashamed. You got to do it publicly. And lastly, I'll tell you this. You got to do it now. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Don't wait. You ain't got tomorrow. You don't know you got tomorrow. We were talking about that in James. We're not guaranteed tomorrow, but we got today. So listen to me. If you're here this morning and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, or you know maybe it was you didn't really do it, today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of salvation. Pray with me. Dear God, we come to you this morning. And Lord, I believe in this room there's some here that have heard the gospel, and this morning they understand it. Maybe they never understood it before, why you had to die and why you are the only way, but today they get it because of your sacrifice and what you've done for us, and we can't do it. And so, Lord, right now, in the quietness of this moment, Lord, I ask that your Spirit would work. Lord, if there's somebody here that does not know you and they feel that right now, they feel that tug on their heart, that Holy Spirit draw, that this morning they would come to know you in a real and a personal way. Lord God, I don't know what's going on in each heart, but I know you do. So Lord, I pray for that person that you give them boldness. They want to come and profess their faith in you today publicly. Lord, for the Christians in here, Lord, that are maybe weary and they need encouragement, I pray, Lord, maybe there's somebody in their life they need to, you've put laid on their heart, and they need to pray for them, Lord, and they want to just come and use the altar. God, whatever. Lord, have your way this morning in our lives. And we ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen. I'm going to ask you if you would to stand with me. As we come to this invitation time, we just want to give you a chance to respond to God's word. If you're here this morning and you need to make a decision public, we'll give you an opportunity to do that. If you want to come and just use the altar, it's open. Whatever God's saying, we will give you a chance to do today in this time. And I'll tell you, do it now. It'll never be any stronger than it is right now, that pull. So you do what God's leading you to do as we sing. Hey, have a quick seat. I want to tell you, I'm so glad you're here today. Remember, next week's Easter. Invite someone with you. One of the things we've got, I just want to remind you, is some, we got some cards right here, and these are just like invitation cards. They've got the times on them, and it just says, come and sit with me. So invite someone to come and sit with you next week. Well, we want to have, I'd love to fill up two services. So, and I'd love to put chairs out too. I don't care. Make it a fire hazard. I don't care. So, also want to let you know, if you don't, that Thursday night we're going to have a Lord's Supper here, and it's kind of a special time. So we want to just really celebrate what Jesus did for us on the cross, and that's what that does. It says we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes, and who knows, it may be pretty soon, maybe your last one. I hope it is. But anyways, so that's Thursday night at 6. And I'd love for you to come and be a part of that with us. Now, real quick, I want to tell you about a decision today. Come on up here, Courtney. This is Courtney Provert, and Courtney's coming today. She's been saved, but she's coming. She wanted to really rededicate her life, but she also said she wants to follow the Lord in baptism. So we want to do that. I'm going to talk to her a little bit about that. But you know what? Sometimes these decisions right here are huge. Some of us may need to follow what Courtney's doing here, and maybe you need to be rededicate your life as well. It's a challenge for you. So in just a minute, Gary's going to come and pray. If you would, I'm going to have Jean, would you come and stand with her? Is Steve Becker? Are you got people with you, Becker? You want to come and stand with her too? Come on up here, Steve. He didn't know he's going to have to do that, did you? So pray for her. Come by and tell her you're going to be praying for her, and give her a good Baptist hug or something, all right? Gary's going to close us out. Gary's one of our deacons. We appreciate him. And he's going to close us out this morning.
Before I pray, we need to mention that we're having deacon nominations in a few weeks. And we just want to mention, if you just read the scriptures that tell you about that. I've been a deacon for over 10 years, and we do important work. We work for the church. That's who we work for, our pastor. So we just thank who you're voting for, and you look around and pick who you believe would be a good deacon. Let's pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you. It's such an honor to come to you, come into your church, Lord, and just to study the Word, just to hear a good preacher tell us, Lord, what we need to know, what the way to go, Lord, and just help us with that, Lord. We just thank you for that. Again, we ask you, as we go to home, Lord, just put people in our lives that we can tell them about you, Lord, because the way the world is today, Lord, you are the only answer, and that is perfectly clear. Again, we thank you for all you do and all you are, Lord. We praise your mighty name. Amen.